Okay, welcome. So the third part in our series of Beyond Blockchain is going to be about altcoins and the different platforms that are considered third generation. So let's begin. So one of the third generation platforms or altcoins that are out there is called EOS. You can actually go on their website, which I have the link here at eos.io, to get all the up-to-date information. But again, things move so fast. This is a snapshot of September 9th, 2020 as to the state of where EOS is at. So they just about a year and a half ago separated off of the Ethereum platform. They were part of an Ethereum coin, and then they actually moved into their own coin as well. So that's something that's not so much reflected here. They do use C++ for a lot of their development as far as coding. It's called a delegated proof of stake. So again, it's a proof of stake. So there, in this case, there's no transaction fees and no forks, which is kind of interesting, which is some of the limitations that you see in some of the earlier blockchain modalities. They really felt that it was important. The developers, particularly Daniel Larimer, who's their CTO, who also previously did Steam and BitShares, which are still up and running. He's part of the core team. There's also a company associated with this called Block.One. Out of the Cayman Islands. At any rate, some of the things that they really saw as the limitations of what was going on with Ethereum is that these transaction fees were going to wear down the network. It's going to start getting too expensive at some point when they really just wanted to have a platform that people could develop on and really make use of the network itself. So they didn't want to have that limitation. So they changed that by using the delegated proof of stake consensus mechanism instead of the other type. The other thing that's really interesting is this is it's actually probably the fastest platform out there right now. They can roughly go at 3,000 transactions a second, which is way above anybody else currently. When you consider that Visa runs about almost 1,700 transactions per second, they could effectively almost double what Visa transacts on a global scale. So that's pretty impressive when you consider how many of these platforms are out there and haven't been able to scale with that transaction speed yet. The issuance is heavy. They have a lot of coins out there, comparatively speaking, to the other types of coins. Right now circulating, there's about 936 million as of today's date. They also have a constitution for governance. So they actually came up with a platform constitution on how to establish jurisdiction, choice of law, because they understood from some of the limitations we saw on the contracts, how do you choose those things? How do you decide what are the rules going to be with your smart contracts? So that they actually have some of those things already in place with mutually accepted rules. So you kind of have a playground, a sandbox, if you will, that already has rules set in place for you to work within. Mostly there's decentralized stakeholders. There's also developers. However, there's been, and particularly in the initial stages, a heavy influence from Block.One and the core team for early developments. That's starting to broaden out quite a bit from where it was. And that was really in the early days, was a point of concern for a lot of people, is how truly decentralized is this operating system. And it turns out it's getting better every day. It does separate from the Ethereum coin, and it roughly seems to be going at about a 5% inflation rate a year with the EOS token, which is a standard coin. Really what they're looking for is they want to, as they all say, want to be the Ethereum killer. So right now everybody compares themselves to Ethereum, since that was the first of its version, which really has the most developers and all those things behind it. But it also, because it's got such a large community in Ethereum, it's like making changes is like turning the Titanic, whereas a lot of these others are more nimble in that situation. So EOS is one of those. They have partnerships for decentralized applications, different application interfaces or APIs, different exchanges, and proof of stake partners. So here's the second coin called Cardano. And this is another one of those third generation coins that were developed after Ethereum. In fact, this is one of those coins that they try to talk about as being an Ethereum killer, similar to EOS. Cardano has changed significantly in the past couple of years from the last time I actually looked at Cardano. And some big developments have changed its position in usability, scalability, and whether or not it's going to pull through. Now, the interesting thing about Cardano as well is if you look at the foundational contributors, Charles Hoskinson, who was one of the foundation contributors of Ethereum, left Ethereum and created the Cardano Foundation. He works with the company Input Output Hong Kong, where they do all sorts of consulting for all sorts of blockchain projects, both in the academic world and commercial world, and also another partnership with Emergo on really helping develop and expand the Cardano platform. The coin itself is called ADA. That's what they use as far as the token. It is a completely separate token. It's programmed in Haskell for the main blockchain, but then they've used some other types of more esoteric softwares like Plutus and Marlow for divining how they do smart contracts, in addition to a lot of application interfaces into other types of languages. What's really interesting about Cardano is that they have partnered with academics all over the world. In fact, if you look at their partnerships, they have hundreds of partners in various areas on the development. And you can see the link down below on the Cardano mind map, which is a great visual where you can see in different sectors of who they're partnering with and what projects that they're developing. And it's just, it's too big to look at on one screen. You have to kind of move around it. It's pretty impressive looking. That's kind of to give you a sense of how many developments are going on. They have really three groups for governance. They have the core developers, and this has to do with the input-output Hong Kong, who's really working on the direction, on the different projects that they're developing. So you kind of think of that, these are the people that make the rules. So it's kind of like the legislative branch. There's also full nodes who then execute those rules. This is kind of like the judicial branch. And then the foundation itself, the Cardano Foundation, which is kind of the executive branch, again, for looking at the far end and getting things incorporated in with other companies and developing partnerships. So it is fully decentralized and it's fully open source. They've been, unlike some of the developments you've seen before, this is fully open source, fully vetted. They actually are welcoming people to poke holes in their developments. That's why they do everything in peer-to-peer journals so that people can look at what they're doing. They are sourcing talent from all over the world. So it's completely open solution. They use this thing called the Ouroboros proof of stake. It's a decentralized proof of stake version as their consensus mechanism. Many different protocols from the CSL application level, peer-to-peer level, time warp, binary protocols, network transport layer protocols. Lots of different things going on. And part of the reason for this is they wanted to make sure that if they're going to put something out there that people are going to make distributed applications on, or they're going to do transactions on, or they're going to do smart contracts on, that it's going to be robust. They want to make it secured, hack-proof, and one of the only groups to actually engage in how to create a platform that is quantum computing hack proof. So quantum computers will be coming online probably within the next decade. And we already have small, type of core computers that are operating through various companies who are working on those things, but they're still kind of in their infancy. But they're planning ahead for the fact that we will have quantum computers, and what you don't want is a quantum computer that can then hack through your system, whereas a normal binary computer can't. So they're actually planning for that ahead of time. The thing that really has changed in 2020 is they came up with a better scalability solution in terms of the transaction speed. And this took them from, placing lower on the transaction speed rate to way ahead of anybody else. And it's called the Hydra solution, which is why I show the picture of the Hydra here. If you've noticed, they like to use a lot of Greek mythology and things in their names. They also have a Daedalus wallet. which is kind of fun as well. Anyway, so they use a Hydra solution. What does that mean? It basically uses two different levels of platform, and you can look it up on their organization form. They even have the research paper for it as well, where they have the main chain and then a transaction piece, a secured transaction piece to what they call a head that's actually doing these transactions. Each head theoretically can do 1,000 transactions per second, which that in of itself puts it in the higher tier of the different blockchain projects on how fast they can go. However, that's just one head. And the number of heads is virtually infinite, depending upon how many network heads they're going to have. And they're forecasting that they could, you know, easily get up to 1,000 heads as far as the networks could go. And each one of these will be operating independently. Well, if each one's doing 1,000 transactions per second, you multiply that by 1,000 heads, and now you've got 1,000,000 transactions per second. So this thing is infinitely scalable with super fast speeds. So that's probably the latest and greatest thing that has really come down the pipeline from Cardano, aside from the different types of partnerships that they're doing in fintech, decentralized finance, and a whole bunch of areas that they're diving into. So I just wanted to give you the updated slide on that. There really is a few differences, and we've talked about some of those. Really, the biggest difference between EOS and Cardano is the speed of transactions, which we said EOS is actually much faster, and their consensus algorithms. So a delegated proof of stake versus the Ouroboros proof of stake, which is a very specific type. I have links to other videos if you would like to see like a one-on-one comparison, and also more specific videos of those types of coins. And the list goes on. There are so many coins and so many things out there. It's nearly impossible for one person to try to keep up with all of them. So part of the project that we will eventually do in our class is have you guys actually research this process and not only pick a coin, but research one of these platforms and take a deep dive into it. All right. Thank you so much. And I will see you in class. Take care.